Howdy, guys. Just got a call from a buddy, John. He's got a Cessna 340 he keeps at Aurora. He knows I've been down for a long time waiting on paint, so he offered me a ride today. So come along and I'll show you guys the difference between the Cessna 340 and the Cessna 310. Alrighty guys, taxiing out Skyhaven and Aurora, which you guys are used to, just on John's side. The 340 flight will explain some of the differences. We're going to pick up an IFR clearance, get going, and we'll talk to you guys about some of the differences between the 340 and the 310. Got a full plane, 5 on board, pressurized comfort. Going to pick up the ATIS, and here we go.
And Aurora Tower, Twin Cessna 6827 Lima. We are just outside Skyhaven, IFR to Rockford, and ready to copy clearance.
27 Lima, Aurora Ground, you're cleared to the Rockford Airport via radar vector Simon direct. Climb maintain 3,000, expect 12,010 minutes after departure. Departure frequency is 133.5 squawk 4357.
6827 Lima is cleared to Rockford via radar vector Simon direct Rockford 3,000, 12,010, 133.5. Squawk up 4357, ready to taxi with Kilo.
27 Lima, runway 27, taxi via Alpha, and verify you have information, Kilo.
27 via Alpha, we got Kilo.
Seat belts and shoulder harnesses.
All set. Passengers, seat belts, shoulder harnesses.
Good, yep. Okay. Parking brake.
Parking brake release.
And we're ready for takeoff.
Okay, Kevin, once you handle the comms, we got 120.6 on 1.
Alright. Let me check base. Looks good. Final looks good. No one. Aurora Tower, November 6827 Lima, ready to go. Runway 27 IFR, Rockford.
We're 27 Lima Tower, hold short runway 27, awaiting IFR release.
Twin Cessna 27 Lima, holding short 27.
27 Lima Tower, wind 220 at 12, gust 17 on departure, turn right heading 290, runway 27, clear for takeoff.
Right turn heading 290, runway 27, clear for takeoff. Twin Cessna 27 Lima. All right, I'm clear of everything.
Number 27 Lima, there is VFR traffic about 5 miles northwest of the field southbound, indicating 3,300 feet, type unknown.
Twin Cessna 27 Lima, we'll be looking.
All right, we're gonna bring the throttles in nice and slow on this aircraft because it's turbocharged and we don't wanna overboost. Alright, full power. Airspeed's alive. Engine instruments in the green. 60, 70, 80, 90, and rotate. And we're gonna tap brakes, positive rate. Gear up.
This is what it's like to be in the air again.
November 02 at Mike, wind 220 to 13, gust 17. Right turn to the north approved. 27, clear for takeoff.
240 Juliet, Mike, clear for takeoff. 27.
And you're looking for that traffic?
Yep.
The screen.
Number 6827 Lima, traffic no factor, and contact departure 133.5, good day.
27 Lima, switching to departure, good day. Chicago departure, Twin Cessna 6827 Lima is with you climbing out of 1,900 for 3,000.
November 6827 Lima, Chicago departure, ident, climb and maintain 4,000.
27 Lima, ident up to 4,000, and even though it's a short flight, we just want to test something out, so we do actually want 12 eventually.
Okay, yeah, we'll get Jack going on up here.
Thanks, Steve.
You know him?
Yeah.
650 Connect Chicago Center, 120.12.
Alrighty. Got a nice cruise climb set up?
Yep.
At a 2.5 for 4.
November 27 Lima, you can actually start on up to 10,000.
27 Lima up to 10,000, thank you.
Got a nice cruise climb going. I'm going to change our cruise ascent up to 120 knots.
So a couple things. John does have the STAC 3100, so he's got that programmed up to 10,000 feet. He's doing an indicated airspeed climb of 120. You guys can see it's locked on to 120 there. He's in heading mode on the 290 heading. And another cool thing to bring up is if you notice the passengers back there are just talking freely with no headsets. Just talking freely. That is the joys of a pressurized airplane. Much better soundproofing, insulation, quieter. It's a little tough to do that in a 310.
Yeah. Well, now we're going to maintain 31.5 inches of manifold pressure all the way up to our cruising altitude.
And
really nice. And we're going to climb out better than 1,000 feet a minute with 5 passengers on board, full fuel.
Can't beat that.
Nope.
The cabin class comfort.
November 6827 Lima, climb maintain 1 to 2,000. Go dogs.
27 Lima up to 12,000. Go dogs. Buddy Eric, who is a Bulldog fan, he understands the right teams to root for.
There you go.
He's excited about the new paint scheme.
I'll bet. I'm excited about it. Keep waiting to see how Hawk Aircraft does with that thing.
Yep.
Looks good so far.
Yeah, can't wait. So, it's almost freezing here. 0 degrees. Just trucking along.
Yeah, so right now we don't even have the heater on. We're just using bleed air off the turbos.
It's comfy.
Pressurized air heat.
Yeah, that's awesome. All right, so we discussed earlier one of the big differences in this airplane versus mine is the pressurization controls. So I'll let John explain what we're looking at here with the pressurization.
Yeah, so what we've got is you've got a gauge here. Your gauge is going to show the large knob. The large needle shows your cabin altitude. The small needle shows your cabin pressure. So we've set the cabin for a 2,000-foot cabin. That's about 1,000 feet over pattern altitude is where I like to be at the destination airport. The reason for that is when the aircraft descends, we want it to depressurize before the wheels touch down. Otherwise, when the wheels touch down, the squat switch is going to depressurize the cabin. Could be very uncomfortable.
Uncomfortable to the ears.
Yep. And then the smaller needle, this aircraft will pressurize up to 4.2 PSI. We've set it for a 2,000-foot cabin. Once we get above probably 10 or 11,000 feet, the cabin is going to start to climb because it's not going to hold that much pressure. You're going to see this needle is going to go all the way to about the top of the green, and that's about the time that your cabin is going to climb with the aircraft. About 20,000 feet, we're going to get about an 8,000-foot cabin.
That's awesome. 20,000, 8,000 feet. And then this top one there is showing just the...
So this is showing your cabin rate of climb. So right now, your cabin rate of climb is zero. But as we start getting, say, above 10, 12,000 feet, when it can't hold a 2,000-foot cabin, you'll start to see it climb. The other thing that we can do here is we can set the cabin rate of descent and climb with this knob. So I like about a 500-foot per minute rate of climb and descent.
Sure.
So that's going to come into factor when we're descending from 12,000 feet. We're descending at 1,000 foot per minute. We want the cabin to descend at 500 feet per minute to keep the passengers' ears, not box their ears, not make them uncomfortable.
All right, very cool. So in my plane, we've talked about his turbocharging. I have what's called normally aspirated, so no turbochargers. So they're not...
November 2 Yankee turbocharger.
There's no turbocharger compressing the air to the engine. So as I get higher, I'm losing power. He just stays at the same speed, the same climb rate from the surface, and now we're almost passing 10,000 feet, hasn't budged.
And we're still at a 2,000-foot cabin altitude. You can see now it's just starting to climb at 10,000 feet. We're getting a bit, the cabin's starting to climb with us.
Nice, gentle 250, 300 foot per minute, looks like.
Right.
Climb.
One of the things I like about the Aztec is you never have to worry about your climb. You can set 120 knots for your climb, and it just flies it beautifully.
Yeah, that is great. I don't do, people jump on me all the time because, you know, oh, you should do indicated climbs to protect yourself. I should. I mean, when you're climbing up to really high altitudes, a lot of times I'm just going up to 8, and I'll just set a cruise climb for something that I know will be fine all the way up to 8 or 9,000 feet. But it does still have envelope protection, so even if you try to stall it with the indicated airspeed, it will nose over. So it's a little different than older school autopilots in that aspect. Well, I haven't been to 12,000 in a GA airplane in a while.
There you go.
I think the highest I've had our 310 up to is 11, maybe 11.5, coming back from Sun and Fun last year. Cruise checklist, cruise power.
Cruise power set.
Auxiliary fuel pumps.
Box pumps off.
Mixtures.
Mixtures lean.
Cow flaps.
Cow flaps closed.
Propellers.
Props phased.
Props. Oh, we're covered. Fuel.
Prop synchro phasers on.
Fuel selector.
Fuel selectors are mains.
Cabin altitude and differential pressure.
Okay, so that's really important in this aircraft. What you want to do is make sure, what is my cabin altitude at? Because it can be a very insidious thing. If this thing keeps climbing, we got a leak, and we start getting hypoxic. So you want to check, okay, we've got about a 4,000 foot cabin. The pressurization's holding at about 4 PSI. And I don't have a cabin altitude warning on. So I want to make sure of that because I don't want to get hypoxic up here, so we definitely want to make that part of our scan and not just say check, but actually look at it and look at what the cabin altitude
is.
Say it out loud.
Yeah.
Because I've been guilty of not doing that, and I got a cab warning one day, and I was a little bit surprised.
Yeah, I bet. And Rockford 27 Lima, do have your ATIS, and we are ready for the vectors for the RNAV runway 19 practice approach, if we could do that.
November 27 Lima, roger, turn right, heading of 360, descend to maintain 4,000.
Right turn heading 360, descend to maintain 4,000, 6827 Lima.
November 27 Lima, after the RNAV to runway 19er, stay in touch.
Yeah, after that, we could cancel, get flight following down to Morris, Charlie 09er. We'll go there VFR with flight following.
27 Lima, roger.
We did talk about that. Is that cool?
That's perfect.
Okay. We did discuss before we took off, which is really important. Two people, when you have two pilots in a cockpit, you got to determine who's the PIC at all times and what duties is the non-PIC or the non-flying pilot going to do. So we divvied that up. He's flying. I'm just working radios. And obviously, I'll maintain vigilance for traffic. And if I see anything goofy, never be afraid to say something. If you see something, say something. He can roll his eyes if he wants, but at least we know we got safety in mind. Fuel selectors.
Fuel selectors mains, and I confirmed.
Auxiliary fuel pumps.
Auxiliary pumps low.
Pressurization.
Okay, so this is really important again. Now we see our cabin altitude. We're going down at 1,000 feet a minute, but the cabin's going down just over 500 feet a minute. So our passengers aren't getting their ears beat up.
Yep. Perfect. And that's what this knob does?
That's what this knob does.
Gotcha.
It changes your rate of climb and descent.
Okay.
Where
are we at? Mixtures.
Okay, so mixtures, I like to start bringing them in up here, and that's because I want to internally slowly cool those engines down, not do it all at once.
Gotcha.
Okay.
And cowl flaps?
Cowl flaps are closed.
The altimeter.
Altimeter's set.
So in a pressurized airplane, altimeter is an important part of the descent checklist because up above 17,999, you comes to flight levels, and every pilot sets their altimeter setting to 29 or 9 or 2. Then when you descend back down through 18,000 feet, you got to put the local altimeter setting in.
This autopilot does make everything so much easier than flying all the time.
Oh, absolutely. Like you said, the speeds you go, you know, a lot can happen quick as you get into the terminal environment. It's nice to have something to help break up the workload.
So we're still descending 1,000 feet a minute. Our cabin altitude's coming down around 400.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm very comfortable. If we were doing this in a
oh, man.
Non-pressurized airplane,
you'd see me doing this all the time.
Yeah, right.
Trying to clear my ears.
Doing the Valsalvis thing.
What is that circle? Is that your glide circle?
That's glide.
That's your twin engine failure glide circle?
Yep.
Wow. I did practice that in the sim the other day.
Yeah, Art got me when he knocked both engines out. I'm like, what the heck happened?
He's it took me a second because I was like, all right, the engine failure, you know, like you're stepping on rudders and you're trying to figure out, you're like, wait a minute, there's no power. Just put it in the field. Ended up feathering them both. And
I
kept the gear up and just.
I didn't do as well. That one, I got the big red screen of death, so.
Yeah, it happens.
Turn right, heading 160. Maintain 2,500 till established. Clear RNAV runway 19 approach.
Right, heading 160, at about 2,500 till established. Clear RNAV 19, Twin Cessna 27 Lima.
I'm going to level off for a second. I'm just hitting control wheel steer. Let's get it below 160 knots. We got our power down where we want it.
1-8, descend and maintain 10,000.
Yep, level off with speed.
Yeah, just level up, bleed some speed off. We'll get 10 degrees of flaps in. That'll really slow us down.
Squawk 4262.
And the 340 and the 310 have the same split flaps. A lot of drag.
Love the split flaps.
Yeah. Helps you get down. Now he's got to get below 140 for the gear. Our speeds are the same for the first notch of flaps, the remaining flaps in the gear.
November 27 Lima, contact Tower 18-1.
27 Lima, switching 18-1. Tower Twin Cessna 6827 Lima is with you on the practice RNAV runway 19.
Shut it off.
27 Lima, Rockford Tower, wind 220 at 9.5 on final breakout, the approach, and turn left on course Morse. Maintain VFR header below 3,000. The runway is closed.
27 Lima, will maintain VFR, and we'll go direct Morse, header below 3.
So our go-around procedure would be clean, climb, cram.
November 27 Lima, contact departure.
27 Lima, pushing departure. Departure, Twin Cessna 6827 Lima is with you off the mist. We are now VFR, climbing through 1.7 for VFR at or below 3, direct Morse.
November 6827 Lima, Rockford, departure radar contact. Proceed on course, altitude your discretion.
On course, altitude your discretion. Thank you much, sir. 27 Lima. So, people in this class of airplanes, a lot of times there's got the cabin class twin Cessnas. There are some Navajos and a few other ones, but I would say the twin Cessna definitely owns the cabin class pressurized market. Outside of that, you can start looking, people can step up to turbines. But the nice thing about a twin Cessna versus a turbine, the turbines, you got to get up high. Even if the winds are brutal, you're coming back from east to west. If you don't get a turbine up high, it's so grossly inefficient. But a nice thing, a turbocharged twin Cessna,
transponder and squawk 5-3.
Super efficient up above in the low flight levels, but also not very, you know, pretty efficient down low. You can stay at 3,500 and duck underneath brutal headwinds and still be pretty efficient. You would never think about doing this in a TBM or
5-3-6-3 from the 42.
Conquest
for sure. Alright, take a landing checklist.
Landing checklist coming up. Before landing, seatbelts, shoulder harnesses.
Everybody strapped in? We're gonna land this time.
Prop sync.
Prop sync off.
Cabin differential pressure.
Differential pressure zero.
Wing flaps.
Wing flaps set.
Landing gear.
Gear down, 3 green.
Pictures.
Pictures, rich.
Props.
Props to go.
Approach speed.
Good. 120.
Checklist complete.
Let that tailwind push me out a little bit. Where are the winds? 230? That's what they said. Headwind now. I just wanted to know so I could make a nice square base to final, make it look right.
Yeah.
That was very square.
I never are. Morse traffic, Twin Cessna 6827 Lima is departing runway 18, VFR departure, right turn out to the north, Morse. Don't see anybody on the base, on final. Runway is clear.
Tap brakes, gear up, blue line climb. Looking good.
Could be a quick 21 miles.
Yep.
Man, what a nice day. I needed this. Thank you.
Yeah, it's fun.
Yeah. I needed a little air beneath me.
Yeah, and I'll tell you, it's nice to go out and just fly an airplane for fun once in a while instead of...
Mission.
Yeah, and like, yeah. I mean, it gets busy for me.
Yeah. Aurora Tower, Twin Cessna 6827 Lima is 17 miles to your south, 3,000 feet inbound Lima, full stop.
Enter the left downwind runway 27, report 3 miles out.
Well, enter left downwind 27, report 3 out, 27 Lima. Twin Cessna 27 Lima is 3 south for the left downwind 27.
Cessna 27 Lima, runway 27, clear to land, wind 22011.
27, clear to land, 27 Lima.
I'm going to try a little asymmetric thrust on this landing. So, just going to bring the power up on the upwind engine.
Sure.
When we're getting, I'm going to do it a little ahead of time. Keep, make sure I keep my speed up. Just want to get too uncoordinated.
Clear for the option doing here.
Just to try it as a technique.
Yeah.
So I'm bringing rudder in and a little asymmetric thrust.
Over Tower Skyhawk, Bison 2, Juliet Alpha.
A good, I love this cheater way to make a crosswind landing in a twin. See how smooth we can get it down.
572 Juliet Alpha, Aurora Tower, stay altitude.
3300. Nice. Not perfect, but.
Enter the left downwind runway 27, report midfield.
Helps a whole lot if it was a really strong crosswind.
Yeah.
Although I wouldn't have had full flaps.
27 Lima, can we make the left turn on 18?
Over 27 Lima, negative 18 closed. You can continue down to runway 15 left. Runway 15 left on Alpha. Contact ground point 7.
Left on 15 left on Alpha. Ground point 7. 27 Lima, Roger. You guys have seen. If you like pressurization, you want to get up high above the weather, above the ice. Have turbochargers, little cabin class, comfort, air conditioning. The 340. You got to step up from the 310. Get to the 340. The perfect mix between that and the 400 series Cessnas.
Also a little bit of a little bit more scratch to maintain them, unfortunately.
Absolutely. With all those wonderful systems comes more operating costs. Don't know what the next flight will be. Hopefully going to get one Bravo Charlie from Payne. We'll see. Till next time. See you guys around.